Open your gates, ye monuments of love. Divine thou, Lincoln, on your sovereign hill. Hello, I'm John Bangay, and that was the poet William Wordsworth. Monuments of love, yes, but cathedrals could also be warnings of damnation for those who strayed from the paths of righteousness. And for all, a visit to a cathedral for medieval Christians would be an experience that was quite literally out of this world, especially if the cathedral was Lincoln. Arriving here at this great ancient Exchequer Gate arch, the Christian pilgrim might pause here to buy an indulgence to absolve themselves from their sins before finally confronting the great Romanesque screen of the cathedral. Wow. A daunting encounter made more terrifying by the medieval graphic images of the tortures of hell inserted alongside the entrance doors. For those who mostly lived in medieval squalor, they needed courage to even enter this great building. The cathedral had been founded in 1072 by the Norman bishop Remigius, but his church was badly damaged, first by fire and then earthquake, and only the central entrance arches of this church remain. This great screen was added by Bishop Alexander. It is topped at each end by pinnacles on which sit two famous Lincoln characters. On the southern pinnacle sits the figure of St. Hugh of Avalon, who extended the original 1072 Norman building, adding the glorious Hugh's Choir. His symbol is the swan, recording the legendary friendship he developed with a particularly fierce swan. On the north pinnacle sits a statue of the swineherd of Stowe, a poor pig farmer from Stowe near Lincoln. He decided to give his whole life savings, a horn full of silver pennies, to the building of the cathedral. In return for his generosity, St. Hugh promised he would never be forgotten. Having committed to the Christian journey and finally stepping inside, this is the carefully constructed heavenly vision they would encounter. While outside was all the muck and clamour of medieval life, here in this great space would gently echo with plainsong and radiate the tranquility of paradise. In architectural terms, this is one of the greatest visions of cathedral Gothic architecture. The Purbeck limestone piers with their delicate stone leaf carvings seem to blow in a heavenly wind, and the overarching rib vaults wave like the palm leaves did as Christ entered triumphantly into Jerusalem. It's stone only in name. The vision is of another world. Inspired by the newly completed choir at Canterbury, St. Hugh set about extending the cathedral eastwards in 1191 with a new choir designed by his architect, Geoffrey of Noyers. Noyers has a special place in English cathedral architecture, as does the choir he created. His radical designs and innovations establishing what was to become known as the decorated style. Breaking free from the more prescriptive French influences, these can be seen, particularly in the crocketed shafts, the syncopated double-layered blind arcades, and, most famously, the crazy vault, so called because it seemed to defy architectural logic. Hugh died before the choir was completed, and, following his creation as a saint, the choir was extended further east to contain his shrine, the famous Angel Choir, even more richly embellished and employing devices such as the sculptured spandrels copied from Westminster and the exquisitely carved angels which give the choir its name. St Hugh's shrine was destroyed in the Reformation. All that remains, just the base, together with later embellishments. The great eight-light east window is one of the earliest of its kind. Below and to the other side of the window is a reconstruction of a shrine to Eleanor of Castile, first wife of Edward I, one of the great love marriages of the English crown. After 36 years of loving marriage, she died near here in 1290, and her entrails were interred here, while her remaining body was carried back to London by her grieving husband, every overnight stop being famously marked by an Eleanor cross. Edward's second wife, Margaret, is said to be remembered by a remarkable and very rare superbly carved and undamaged statue outside above the judgment porch. Not far from Eleanor's memorial is a shrine to another woman who climbed from obscurity to become mother to a dynasty of English and Scottish kings. Catherine Swinford, born to a humble knight, became a governess here in Lincoln to the children of John of Gaunt, a powerful noble with royal connections. She became his mistress, and when his wife died, they married and the Pope legitimised their children. Her son, John of Beaufort, was the great-grandfather of Henry VII, the first Tudor King of England, and John Beaufort's daughter, Joan, married James I of Scotland, the first of the Stuart line of Scottish kings. One other notorious figure within the Angel Choir is the famous Lincoln Imp, source of a much-told cautionary tale. The story of the Lincoln Imp is probably a Victorian invention. One day, the devil sent two imps to terrorise the cathedral. They flew about causing mayhem until suddenly one of the stone angels came to life and confronted them. Instantly, one of the imps flew away, but the other sat there and laughingly mocked the angel. Instantly, the angel turned him to stone, and there he sits till Judgment Day with his frozen smile. The choir stalls themselves are richly ornamented with misericords and poppy heads, carvings of humans, birds and fabulous animals. The precentor's seat is embellished with scandal, where the carvers have mocked an Italian cardinal who, at one time, was appointed to Lincoln but who chose to stay in Rome, where his devious methods earned him the nickname Monkey. The carvings depict a monkey stealing and eventually being hanged. As the choirs were completed, so work on the tower, which had partly collapsed, progressed again, along with the north and south transepts. When the tower was completed, a lead-covered timber spire was added, along with smaller spires on the western towers, making the cathedral, for about 250 years, the tallest building in the world. The Dean's Eye in the north transept is the earliest known example of a circular rose window. It warns of the darker side of human nature and the temptations of the devil. In 2000, it was discovered that it was about to collapse. And only by completely rebuilding the window and protecting the delicate glass was disaster averted.
Scary job, wasn't it? It wasn't that much fun.
It was ready to collapse, wasn't it?
It was, well, technically. It was a structural scaffold. And when we took up the old window, we had to have a scaffold inside and outside with big I-beams going through to
hold it.
Port it up. And the old idea of a round window and arch is that you can take out that because all of the forces are sent around the window, and there was the outside ring of stone still there.
Yeah.
So in theory, we should have been fine to take out that. It was built too high into the gable end, which made it.
It's quite high, isn't it? Yeah.
The bishop's side, the other side, is lower down, so it's structurally more sound.
I hadn't noticed that. Oh, yeah.
But
yeah.
And that's probably why there has been movement over the years.
The bishop's eye offers light and life and the paths of righteousness. It employs a delicate curvilinear technique which links the lines of the medieval glass in a beautiful, delicate design. The main cathedral was completed around 1380, when the great nave was extended from the central crossing to the original Romanesque west end. Lincoln Cathedral's Chapter House is another example of early English architectural innovation. It was built between 1220 and 1235, and the 10 sides are supported by these great flying buttresses, which were added later. Parliament met here twice, and on the latter occasion, in 1301, King Edward I created his son, Prince of Wales, better known as the Black Prince. Adjacent to the Chapter House are the cathedral cloisters, unusually for a cathedral, on the north side of which sits the Wren Library, one of the few buildings outside London actually designed by the great architect. In 1545, the great central spire was destroyed in a storm. And in 1810, the two western spires were removed for safety reasons. In the early 20th century, the southwestern tower nearly collapsed and was only rescued by the heroic efforts of the cathedral masons. Lincoln Cathedral has inspired and encouraged many artists and composers, notably the composer William Byrd, who was cathedral organist from 1563 to 1572, when he became gentleman organist of the Chapel Royal. Father Willis, the great organ builder, was responsible for Lincoln's current organ, said to be the finest in the country. In 1954, the cathedral clergy commissioned the contemporary painter Duncan Grant to paint murals for the Chapel of St. Blaise, the patron saint of wool merchants. Wool merchants and wool taxation on the River Witham had made Lincoln a wealthy city in the medieval times. Grant's murals depict scenes from the life of Christ, including references to sheep and wool, with figures modelled by his Bloomsbury Group associate Vanessa Bell. Recently, the cathedral commissioned the sculptor Aidan Hart to produce this sculpture of Mary, who is the patron saint of this cathedral. Its design is inspired by the earliest known seal of Lincoln Cathedral. Its painted surfaces are a reminder of the colourful way in which many cathedrals and their sculptures were brightly painted before the Reformation. Some traces still remain within the cathedral. During the Second World War, the county of Lincolnshire was home to many bomber and some fighter aircraft squadrons, and there are memorials and a chapel dedicated to the memory of those who fought and died in that and later conflicts. One of the four surviving copies of Magna Carta was held in this cathedral, the only one of the four to carry a name, Lincoln. Facing the west front is Exchequer Gate, a rare three-arched example of a cathedral close gateway. Tokens and souvenirs would have been sold to pilgrims from beneath these arches. Today, the cathedral shop sells less controversial souvenirs, including my drawings. Lincoln is Britain's third largest cathedral, after St Paul's and York, and it plays a large part in the life of the city of Lincoln, a city itself endowed with other rich historical remains from Roman and later medieval times. There are many services and lay events, concerts and other performances both inside and outside the cathedral throughout the year. When you enter this door, you will encounter culture, community and, above all, communion with God in a most extraordinary and rewarding way. A few years ago, I was privileged to work for a summer as a volunteer in this great cathedral. Sometimes, on a summer's morning, unlocking the doors and walking alone into this great space, following in the footsteps of kings, queens, and countless thousand commoners who trod for nearly 1,000 years.